Imagine if Izuku found his true home in someone's arms. Today, we explore how this change could reshape his journey. Let's dive in. See you tomorrow? A small sigh escaped her lips. Same time as always. Rumi Yusujiyama opened the doors of the huge city hall building where she usually delivers the reports of her heroic session. The faint sparkles of the stars and the enormous moonlight greeted her warmly. As always, the night welcomed her one more day. A new heavy sigh came out of his mouth and he began to walk through the crowd. His traditional backpack where he carried nothing but his hero costume. The same people around him. The same music. His gaze on the ground and his tired gaze wandering aimlessly denoted his overwhelming routine. What should I have for dinner today? The girl wondered to herself as she continued on her way. The constant gusts of icy wind gently hit her face. Her ears moved softly in unison with her white hair. It had been a while since she left her old home, family and friends to follow her dream of being a heroine. Although at first everything was new and an adventure for her, after a while the harsh reality knocked on her door. Huh, her ears moved in one direction and her nose began to sniff something. If there was one thing that characterized Rumi Yusujiyama, it was those two qualities. Carrot cake. Her gaze sharpened and a fierce smile appeared on her face. The girl deviated from her usual path, letting herself be carried away by that delicious aroma. Although her obligation as a hero took her to different parts of the city, it was also true that she could never allow herself to enjoy those paths. So having taken that different path guided by her instincts was something new for her. She observed her surroundings in detail. Street food stalls, bars, karaoke bars. An endless number of everyday things that opened up a new world for her and she let herself be amazed. His ears twitched in one direction and his nose instantly sniffed. Bingo! Rumi smiled as she arrived at her destination, guided by the same fate. A small bakery, warm at first sight, that encouraged her to enter. From the outside it looked rural, comfortable. Letting herself go once again, she opened the door of the establishment. A couple of waitresses and chairs decorated the place. Warm lights and jazz music in the background made the whole thing. The sweet aroma of different types of desserts instantly enveloped him, but the smell of that carrot cake predominated in his instincts. Oh, welcome. A warm voice mentioned unexpectedly. A short lady with green hair and eyes of the same color greeted her. Ha, hello. The rabbit girl left her backpack on one of the chairs in the establishment and walked towards where the lady resided. Carrot cake. Despite her strong temperament as a hero, outside of that facet the girl didn't know much about how to interact in a relaxed manner. The lady smiled warmly and nodded slightly. They will be ready in a few seconds. The smile on Rumi's face didn't take long to appear and she anxiously moved her nose slightly, sniffing in the distance the sweet smell of that desired dessert while her foot tapped the ground and her bunny tail moved, both involuntarily. After a few minutes the aroma became stronger and on a tray, a tall boy with green hair and freckles on his face appeared to save her. Excuse me, miss. How many would you like to take? The lady asked, attracting the girl's attention, who indicated the number of cakes with her fingers. 10 cakes will be. The lady answered, somewhat nervous, and surprised by the answer. As the lady and the green-haired boy packed the cakes, the rabbit girl watched the action intently, noticing the sidelong glance that the freckled boy cast on her. Having everything ready, the rabbit girl took her precious treasure and with a smile on her face left that warm bakery, happy and eager to devour those cakes. Inside the bakery, the green-haired lady noticed something. Izuku, the backpack. Rumi Yusujiyama was so eager to devour those carrot cakes that she had completely forgotten her backpack. As Rumi continued walking and enthusiastically observing her surroundings that she had just discovered that very day, her ears noticed some accelerated footsteps approaching her. Excuse me. A voice called from behind. Rumi turned around instantly to see how the freckled boy was running towards her with his backpack in his hands. Oof. The boy gasped. It's good that I managed to reach her in time. The boy smiled slightly as he tried to catch his breath. After a few seconds of recovery, the boy offered that backpack to Rumi. Thank you. The girl took her backpack and placed it on her back. They both stared at each other in awkward silence as the boy smiled nervously at her. Excuse me. I don't want to be a bother, but could you give me an autograph? The boy finally formulated that phrase that made him so nervous. In front of Rumi's eyes, a small notebook was placed with a drawing of her and information about her person, peculiarity and heroic abilities. Her eyes widened and her being filled with surprise. It was true that she was a heroine, but unlike several colleagues such as Ryukyu or Midnight, she was just starting out, so being recognized was still something new for her. Taking the notebook, she skimmed over what was written on it. It was a lot of information for someone new. Are you some kind of geeky kid? The girl said playfully as she signed her drawing of herself. Hee hee. The boy let out a small nervous laugh. I like to learn about heroes, but I really admire the ones I find incredible. The boy received the notebook that now had the autograph of the heroine Mirko. Rumi looked at the boy slightly, still in surprise. Being closer to him gave her a better idea of the geeky boy. Tall, with green eyes and hair. Freckles on his cheeks and a cute smile. Huh, you see. The boy said in the air, attracting Rumi's attention, who was absorbed in observing him. As a thank you, I would like to give you this carrot cake. I imagine you really want to try it, and that way you don't have to wait until you get home. The boy moved his hands towards her again, but this time with a small carrot cake. The girl looked at him again. That gesture attracted her gaze and her smile, all her attention. Rumi took that small cake in her hands and a slight involuntary smile appeared on her face. I hope you like them. The boy smiled softly as he watched the rabbit girl. It was a pleasure meeting you, Miss Mirko. The boy waved goodbye to Rumi and ran away to get back as quickly as possible. Rumi, realizing this, tried to stop him, but failed abruptly. Your name? The girl sighed in defeat when she realized how far away that boy was. Rumi turned her gaze to that carrot cake which she brought to her nose to smell. Instantly that sweet aroma that had been brought to her earlier at that bakery shook her again. Convinced, the girl now brought the cake to her mouth and gently decided to get drunk on that sweet dessert. This is delicious, her rosy cheeks and sweet smile on her face showed her happiness. Maybe I'll come back for more cakes, Rumi continued on her way home. Maybe I can ask her name too. That her return home had been so different, full of new things and a few carrot cakes, was not something that was in her plans. But neither was wanting to know the name of that freckled boy in her plans. Something new had happened that day for Rumi Yusajiyama, and despite wanting to hide it, she couldn't deny how happy she was. Oh. Welcome back, miss. If Rumi Yusajiyama had to find a couple of reasons to find herself back in that little bakery, she could easily mention the delicious carrot cakes she had eaten. How amazing it was to discover this new part of the city, the streets full of life, the atmosphere and the people. But there was something else too. He looked for something behind the woman with the warm smile. When he heard the woman's call, he decided to go back to that place. Ha, carrot cake, please. And as usual, she found the interaction a bit difficult. The lady let out a warm, faint smile. Of course. Rumi received the long-awaited carrot cake and walked to one of the available tables to take a seat. The sweet and intoxicating taste instantly enveloped her once again as she tasted the creamy cake. This is the best thing I've ever tasted, the rabbit girl whispered with a faint crimson on her cheeks, letting herself enjoy that sweet taste. I'm glad to hear that. A voice right next to her blurted out, to Rumi's surprise. The girl quickly moved her gaze towards where that voice came from, and before her eyes was that tall boy with green hair and freckles with a faint smile and a cup of coffee in his hands. Sorry to break your peace. The boy gave her a small smile. This is for you. It's on the house. The boy left the cup right in front of Rumi. The girl stared at the boy, her confusion showing. A small chuckle escaped the boy's lips. A cake tastes better with some accompaniment. Rumi, slightly hesitant, took the cup in her hands. The instant she brought it close to her face, the faint scent of sweet coffee enveloped her senses. Wah, the girl murmured happily as she tasted the sweet and intoxicating flavor of the coffee. After taking a sip of the coffee, the girl put the cup down on the table with a faint, happy smile and a blush on her cheeks. And, intoxicated by the flavor, she completely ignored the fact that the foam from the coffee she had drunk was on her face as if it were a mustache. Oh! How cute! The boy whispered into the air, watching in amazement as the girl noticed him. Rumi quickly wiped her face with a napkin, her cheeks a faint crimson and her brow furrowed as she looked at the boy who was now posing in front of her with a small, nervous smile. You've got them pretty good, eh, kid? The bunny girl blurted out. She wasn't upset, she just wanted to tease the boy. I'm sorry. The boy apologized with a nervous smile and was about to leave, if it weren't for a hand that stopped him. Wait. I didn't get a chance to ask for your name when you gave me the cake. Rumi stared at the surprised boy. Huh. The boy smiled as he looked at Rumi. I'll exchange that information with you if you allow me to accompany you. I wouldn't let an opportunity like that slip away. So you do have them right. The girl sharpened her smile as she stared at the boy. Convince me and maybe I'll grant you that pleasure. But don't try to call her pretty or anything like that, I've heard that a lot. The rabbit heroine, Mirko, was an arrogant personality. She knew what she was capable of and would not lower herself for anything, so there was nothing that could afflict that side of her. Oh, don't worry. I don't think something as banal as calling you pretty is an adjective that can compare to you. You go beyond any existing or future expression, Miss Mirko. You exceed all my expectations. But that boy was good with words. TSK, the averted gaze and her annoyed expression were just a facade to cover her embarrassment. Rumi moved the chair in front of her with her leg, leaving enough space for the boy to sit down. As the boy took a seat, he let out a chuckle. Izuku, Izuku Midoriya. Rumi stared at the boy. Now that tall boy with green hair, freckles and a cute smile had a name. Rumi Yusujiyama, you brat. Rumi was still embarrassed. It didn't take long for the two to empathize. Rumi Yusujiyama's strong temperament was harmoniously linked with Izuku Midoriya's confident empathy. It had been a while since her carrot cake had been finished and only the small sips she took of her coffee served as an excuse to continue chatting with Izuku. At that time, several customers were coming in and out. The small gusts of icy wind that blew through the small openings in the door enveloped the rabbit heroine's senses, causing her ears to move constantly, attracting the boy's attention. They are sensitive. When it's cold, it becomes a problem. Rumi confessed, gently caressing one of his ears. Does it hurt? Izuku asked with some curiosity and concern in his words. I always carry some small protectors that my mother gave me. But today I forgot them. A small smile appeared on her face. In that short period of time, Izuku realized Rumi Yusujiyama's duality. She was a sensitive girl who acted strong in front of everyone. But it doesn't matter. If I let something as insignificant as that be an impediment, I shouldn't call myself a hero. The girl sharpened her gaze. Izuku chuckled lightly under his breath, observing the girl's duality. By the way, how old are you? Rumi asked, looking at Izuku. I'm 17 years old. And I'm also studying medicine. The boy replied with a small smile. I'm just saying that to be interesting. Rumi let out a laugh. You're only 4 years younger than me, enough to be a brat. Rumi smiled ferociously. But medicine is something new. Aren't you interested in being a hero? The boy gave him a small smile. Of course, ever since I can remember that had been my dream but. A quirkless isn't made of it. A small silence enveloped both of them. Rumi stared at Izuku, despite his smile, that boy carried a weight on his back. Izuku, I need your help. Behind them both, that short lady called the boy. I have to go. The boy smiled faintly, staring at Rumi. Oh. The boy's voice brought her out of her trance. Of course. Rumi stood up ready to leave that cafeteria. Wait a moment, I won't be long. Izuku stopped Rumi and quickly disappeared from her sight. The confused rabbit girl complied with what Izuku said and waited standing until he reappeared. It's a cold night. So maybe coffee will help a little. Izuku returned instantly and in his hands he was carrying a thermos with coffee and a small chocolate cake. The carrot one is delicious. But the chocolate one is my favorite, so I thought you should try it. It's a gift from me. The boy smiled warmly at Rumi. Rumi looked at the boy from head to toe. She had lost count of how many times she had observed him in such detail and yet she kept discovering something new about him. No need. I'll pay for that. Rumi received a refusal from the boy. Let me pay or I'll rip off both your legs. I have a better idea. Izuku interrupted Rumi as a chuckle escaped his lips. How about you join me for a stroll around the city one of these days? There are still a couple of things I'd like to know about you, Miss Mirko. That smile of Izuku's was beginning to bother her. Not because it was mocking or condescending. Much less because she disliked it. But because she was beginning to like seeing him smile. It's clear to me that you're not afraid of dying, brat. Despite her sharp gaze, her crimson cheeks gave her away a little. I wouldn't want to miss the opportunity to see you one more time. Rumi smiled, but unlike other times, it was a warm smile. Very well, I will grant you the pleasure, child. You already granted it to me by smiling at me like that. Her cheeks burned a little more and her gaze sharpened with embarrassment. Rumi Yusujiyama wasn't aware of what her limit was to bear embarrassment, but she was beginning to suspect that it would be a few sweet words from Izuku Midoriya. See you later, brat. Rumi said goodbye and quickly left the small bakery under Izuku's amused gaze. Bye. Izuku said goodbye, watching as Rumi walked away. How cute, Izuku murmured gracefully. Am I going to be a grandmother yet? Her mother appeared behind Izuku, giving him an unexpected scare. In the street surrounded by gusts of a freezing wind being illuminated by the streetlights and a few stars in the night sky. Rumi took her phone and observed in detail, Christmas was near. A small sigh came out of her mouth and she glanced behind her, where that warm pastry shop was. A small smile appeared on her face. Her ears did not stop moving, as did her nose and her bunny tail that danced in unison. "It's true that it helps a little," Rumi mentioned, drinking some coffee to try to cover her crimson cheeks. "And you guys calm down," the girl moved her free hand up to her ears to caress them delicately. "It is said that rabbits tend to move their most sensitive limbs when they are happy. Perhaps Rumi Usagiyama could try to build the strongest facade to cover her shame, but in the end, there is no hiding the obvious. Shit. It's so unbearably cold." If Rumi Usagiyama had to think of a reason for her being there, she could say that the view she had seen the previous days had pleased her to the point of making her leave the house. She felt strange. She only left the gym to attend to her duties as a hero and nothing else. Wake up, have breakfast, exercise, work, eat, return home and sleep. That was her routine during her entire stay at the academy until a couple of days ago. "Sorry to keep you waiting," a voice echoed from behind her. A small, sharp smile appeared on her face and she turned around until she was faced with the owner of that voice. "You have a lot of guts to ask me out. But even more to make me wait, kid," Rumi mentioned, staring at him with a frown. Izuku did nothing but observe her closely. Despite the cold, Rumi Usagiyama was wearing only a black skirt with a pair of long stockings of the same color, a white blouse and a red leather jacket. Izuku's gaze on her was such that Rumi began to feel embarrassed. "You stare too much, brat," the rabbit mentioned, trying not to look the boy in the eyes. "Do you know what Stendhal syndrome is?" Izuku asked, still staring at the girl. "Huh?" The rabbit tilted her head, confused. "You see," Izuku let out a small laugh. "In short, it's the elevation of the heart rate that a subject experiences when exposed to a work of art. I had read that a long time ago and I realized that something like that had never happened to me." The boy smiled slightly, looking at Rumi's red eyes. Until this very moment. Rumi Usagiyama was learning how dangerous Izuku Midoriya's words could be. "TSK," Rumi looked away, blushing slightly. "You're safe for now, brat. But make me wait one more time and I promise you won't be able to walk for quite a while." Izuku let out a light laugh and walked over to stand next to Rumi. "Make you wait again?" Izuku smiled innocently at the girl. "Are you asking me out in the future?" "You're not so lucky, brat." Rumi, despite the small blush on her cheeks, knew how to intimidate with her gaze. "Ow. But don't worry. If you didn't invite me, I would come up with some cheap trick to convince you that I'm a good option." Too bad that look didn't work on Izuku Midoriya. Rumi had enough built-up embarrassment and to go unnoticed, she lightly slapped the boy's arm and started walking away from him. I could have easily done that after the boy's first 5 minutes of tardiness, but she didn't. Her excuse was that she would be too lazy to go home than to wait another 5 minutes for him. "Miss Rumi," the boy called once while standing near her, slightly attracting the rabbit's attention. The girl watched as a single red rose landed near her. Izuku's faint, warm smile aimed at her presence and his bright green eyes watching her tenderly made her float for a few moments. "Is it for me?" the girl asked, stopping in her tracks. Their gazes met again for a few moments, enough to realize that he might start to like green. Izuku nodded slightly with a soft movement of his head and delicately took Rumi's hand to give her the rose. "I decided that I would search, even if I had to travel around the world, for a flower more beautiful than you." The boy moved his gaze until it rested on Rumi's. "My journey begins today." The cold December wind caressed them both gently. The boy's slightly red nose dipped into a small smile as he looked at Rumi, who was still standing, with that rose in her hand. "TSK." Rumi's nose began to move delicately, as did her tail. The girl tried to look away at her surroundings to try to hide the fact that those words had managed to embarrass her. Her crimson cheeks and soft gaze fell on that rose, which she delicately moved to her white hair, leaving it near one of her rabbit ears, showing it off and showing it off to the world as a unique treasure. "If I'm honest, I don't think I'll ever be able to find a flower that can imitate your unique beauty, Miss Rumi," Izuku mentioned without taking his gaze off her, as if it were a spell. "Let's go now." Rumi had kept all her embarrassment to herself until she left. She placed her hand on Izuku's face to make him look away from her and walked away from him again. The boy let out a small laugh as he watched Rumi wander her gaze everywhere and, without her being aware of it, a warm and faint smile appeared on Rumi Usagiyama's face. "I would like to know more about you," Izuku mentioned in the air, arriving again to where Rumi was. The rabbit looked at him out of the corner of her eye. "What would you like to know, boy?" "Everything." The boy smiled. "I would like to know everything about you, Miss Rumi." They took a couple of steps in silence until a small giggle escaped the girl's lips. "Okay, brat. I'll enlighten you with that joy," the rabbit mentioned with a small smile as she brought her hand up to gently caress the rose resting between her white hair. The streetlights that illuminated their path began to slowly fade as they continued on their way. Lost and unaware of where they were going, they let themselves be carried away by comfort. Luckily for them, the glow of the faint stars above them served as a guide on their path. As they continued on their way, Rumi told Izuku all of her experiences with great enthusiasm, from her childhood, her time as a student and potential hero to the moment when they both met. Rumi's small imitations of punches in the air and euphoric laughter filled Izuku with excitement, who simply listened in admiration to everything the rabbit said. "Being a hero is great, but..." The girl let out a small sigh of exhaustion. "There are times when I wish I could come home and get a hug from mom." They both arrived at a small park where there was only a gigantic tree. Involuntarily they both walked until they lay prostrate under that tree where Rumi decided to sit on the grass. "When I was sad, mom used to gently caress my ears. I never liked it when people touched them, but when she did, I felt like everything would be okay." Rumi looked at the sky and between the branches of that giant tree, the faint sparkles of the stars reached her red eyes. A couple of seconds of silence reigned between them again. Once again the gusts of the icy winter wind enveloped them and the girl's rabbit ears began to move gently from side to side. Izuku delicately approached Rumi, and gently began to bring his hand closer to her, and before he could achieve his goal, Rumi noticed, abruptly moving away from him slightly. "I'm sorry," Izuku mentioned with slight surprise and embarrassment. "Ah. It's okay." The girl watched as Izuku's hand began to move away little by little, and surprisingly, she gently took it. Rumi brought Izuku's hand up to one of her ears and with his help, she began to gently caress it. "They are sensitive," the girl whispered with some embarrassment. "I know, I'll keep that in mind," Izuku mentioned softly as he looked at Rumi. They both remained in a small silence where Izuku placed himself closer to Rumi so he could continue delicately caressing her ear and thus also have the perfect excuse to be by her side. "If you tell anyone about this, I'll kill you, kid," Rumi's faint voice showed his shame at that moment. "Don't worry. I'm very envious and I wouldn't like anyone to see this side of you." The girl's gaze was always on the grass, but from time to time her gaze would wander to Izuku, who with a warm smile was so focused on her that it embarrassed her even more. They both remained like that for a while, where light gusts of wind continued to envelop them both and the night became more present. Some of the leaves of the trees came loose, falling freely without a fixed direction, until one fell on Rumi's white hair. "Plant girl," Izuku muttered gracefully, removing the leaf that had landed on Rumi. The rabbit girl looked at Izuku and with a small, ferocious smile, she moved her hand up to Izuku's green hair and gently moved it. "Bush boy." They both shared a soft laugh as they stood up and left the giant tree that had given them shelter for a few fleeting moments. Their walk continued to be illuminated by the dazzling stars and in a silence so comfortable that if he could speak he would say 1001 things about them. "Rumi." The boy finally broke the silence, attracting the girl's attention. "Would you like to go get some cake? Mom said she'd save some for you." "Of course I do. I'm weak when it comes to those cakes." Rumi smiled fiercely and energetically. "Those cakes are my excuse to get out of my boring routine." Izuku glanced sideways at Rumi, who continued walking with that smile on her face. "Then I already know the key to see you more often." A small giggle escaped from the boy's lips. Rumi stared at Izuku. His smile, his freckles that adorned that smile. His green eyes watching her from time to time when she seemed to be distracted. "Yes." The girl moved her gaze forward and let out a soft smile. "Perhaps there is something else too." They both continued their journey back. Silence was mostly the ruler of their walk, but not many words are needed when silence says everything for them. That, and their sidelong glances accompanied by those silly smiles on their faces. "God, give me patience, because if you give me strength I will kill myself." The heavy sigh that escaped her lips was lost in the complete solitude of that office. The darkness, barely broken by the brightness of her monitor, was beginning to bother her eyes. A couple of days had passed since she shared a moment with that boy in the small bakery, which made her forget a little about her real world, which in the end, the real world always came back to her. "I'd like to eat some carrot cake," she murmured, her tired gaze wandering around her. "I'd like to get out of here." The sighs became heavier. "I'd like to see Izuku." Rumi gently dropped onto her desk, using her arms as a pillow, and slowly closed her eyes. Next to her, a few sheets of paper with reports to fill out accompanied her in her desolate daily life. "Rabbit girl." The softness of that voice made her react little by little. Wake up. A hand on her shoulder moved her gently. Wake up, girl. A sudden movement made her wake up instantly. Surprised and slightly confused, Rumi looked around erratically until she spotted the cause of her discomfort. Bird, I hope you have a good excuse. Her red eyes stared at the boy in front of her, smiling and innocent. It's time to go, Rumi. He smiled at her as he walked away. By the way, there's a kid outside asking for you. I didn't know you had any admirers, being so rude. Shut up, your voice is bothering me, Hawks. Rumi hit the winged boy's head, who merely caressed the affected area. Is the boy a child with green hair and freckles on his cheeks? She tried not to sound too interested. Hawks closed his eyes trying to remember. I think so, why? Oh, nothing in particular. Rumi tried to keep a serious face, although her nose and bunny tail moved involuntarily. As she left the building, the sounds of the city greeted her. Cars, trains, people walking towards uncertain destinations and the crowds mixed with the night, accompanied by stars and gusts of icy wind. Geek boy. Her eyes fixed on the smiling boy in front of her. Hello, Miss Rumi. His smile widened when he saw her. Did you miss me? A mocking chuckle escaped Rumi's lips. Not even a bit, brat. Even though he didn't want to accept it, the movements of her tail gave her away. Izuku knew it. I did miss you. Izuku walked lightly, shortening the gap between them. So I came here to stop drowning my desire to see you. Izuku moved his hand towards one of his ears. Rumi closed her eyes and leaned into his hand. The gusts of wind intensified, but for Rumi, the cold was insignificant at that moment. How did you manage to do that without having your arm torn off? Hawk's voice caught both of their attention. I tried to do that once and ended up on the floor. Hawks watched the situation, incredulous. Are you the rabbit whisperer? Izuku let out a nervous chuckle. A punch to the head from Rumi sent Hawks back a few steps. See? She's aggressive. He received another blow. Now. You're going to make me even more stupid. He frowned. I'm your superior, you should respect me more. Take this and lock the building. He gave a pair of keys to Rumi. It rots. Respect, I said. Hawks interrupted her authoritatively. Annoyed, Rumi walked away from the two of them to carry out the task Hawks had set for her. You have strange tastes, kid. Hawks watched as Rumi cursed into the air. She's a little rude? Izuku laughed. It has its advantages too. She'll complain when I don't put enough ketchup on my burger because I feel sorry for her. Hawks laughed as he looked at the green-haired boy. Let me guess, you're the carrot cake boy? Izuku nodded. Do you know me? Something like that. Rumi mentioned you and your cakes a couple of times at the office. Hawks sighed. I haven't known Rumi for very long, but I've noticed that she lives overwhelmed by her thoughts. Until a couple of days ago, with the arrival of a certain child. Izuku looked at Hawks, who smiled subtly at him. I don't know what you did, but Rumi looks happier. Hawks looked at Rumi, who was still trying to figure out the right key. She may seem like a strong and unbreakable girl, but I trust you to take care of her. The cold winter wind blew hard and the first snowflakes began to fall, melting instantly. Tell Rumi I had to leave. Hawks started to walk away. By the way, the drawing you made of me is really good. Huh? Izuku quickly looked at the box of cakes he was carrying, his notebook that he always carried with him where his hero notes were and in the section dedicated to Hawks, he was already autographing him. I understand your surprise. I'm amazing. Hawks waved goodbye as he turned his back on Izuku. All that's missing is epic background music, explosions, and a counter to make it even more epic. Izuku laughed a little before turning his gaze to where Rumi was, who was still struggling to close that door. Izuku walked towards Rumi, watching her throw tantrums at not being able to close the door. Damn stupid door. Rumi exclaimed. Let me try? Izuku appeared behind her. Good luck, that door is faulty. She handed him the keys, walking away frustrated. Let's see. Izuku took the first of the five keys and closed the door. It wasn't effective, you were just inserting the key wrong. A couple of seconds of silence enveloped them. Rumi, frowning, walked away, annoyed and frustrated. Rumi. Izuku followed her until he found her squatting under a streetlight. He gently placed a small cupcake on her head. Sorry for running away. I look like a little girl throwing a tantrum. Rumi whispered as she took the cupcake. I'm just really tired. A couple of seconds of silence where only the wind moving the branches of the trees was perceptible. Rumi looked at the cupcake and, captivated by the aroma, her nose began to move delicately. She gently brought the cupcake to her mouth where she let herself be intoxicated by the flavor. "Do you like it?" Izuku asked approaching. Rumi nodded slightly. Izuku sat down next to her under the streetlight. People walked around them, disoriented, dodging them as if they were stones. "Do you see all those people absorbed in us?" Izuku mentioned. "They follow their routine and miss out on unique moments." "Like eating cupcakes under a streetlight?" Rumi's question made Izuku laugh. "Exactly. Simple moments become unique. Now, every time I walk by this streetlight, it will be the one that illuminated the night I shared with such an amazing girl like you, Rumi." Rumi moved her gaze towards Izuku, where her senses collided with the boy's green eyes. His warm smile and that pair of freckles that whenever she looked at them, they looked only at her. "Mhm," the girl muttered embarrassed, wandering her gaze in all directions so that Izuku wouldn't notice her embarrassment. Her nose began to twitch as she continued to avert her gaze anywhere but towards Izuku. "What I like about you is that even though you try to hide all your shame, you don't realize that the movements of your nose give you away." Rumi's face flushed a faint red. It was the first time she had done that. Since when had Izuku realized that he was the only one who managed to put her in that situation? Out of the corner of her eye, she watched as Izuku laughed gracefully. She, in her way, would look for some way to get revenge, no matter how much shame would consume her later on. "What I like about you is that you care about me and that makes me happy." His whisper was the most he could say. Rumi was not a girl who talked about her feelings openly, so doing that embarrassed him even more. After the small silence that fell between them, Rumi hid her face between her legs, even more embarrassed than before. "I will always worry about you." Finally, with a smile, Izuku broke the tension of that silence. "You don't have to do that. I can take care of myself," Rumi mentioned while still keeping her face submerged under the protection of her legs. "I know. I know what you're capable of, but I still have this inexplicable feeling of wanting to be close to you." The sound of tree branches intensified slightly. The night that enveloped them was slowly becoming colder. Izuku looked up at the night sky. The bright stars and the dim moon dazzled him slightly before he felt something gently tugging at him. "Then come a little closer." As Izuku shifted his gaze, he stared at Rumi's face. Her cheeks were softly tinted crimson, her unique ruby red eyes watched him tenderly and delicately, and her distressed expression took him by surprise. Izuku heeded the prompting as if a spell had been cast on him. As he felt their bodies subtly touching, his body froze. All his courage seemed to slowly leave his body. "We look like two vagabonds under the light of a street lamp," Rumi mentioned, letting her head fall on Izuku's shoulder. "But I like knowing that this street lamp belongs to both of us." Izuku glanced at Rumi, who was curled up on his shoulder. A sensation ran through his entire being and the noisy environment that surrounded them both turned into complete silence for his senses. "How was your day?" Izuku wanted to find any excuse to make that moment last forever. "You'd be bored if I told you from the beginning." Rumi would accept any excuse to make that moment eternal. "Okay, I have my whole life if it's for you." Rumi let a soft laugh escape her lips. "Maybe I do miss you a little bit." Under the light of any street lamp in the city, so indifferent to the world around them, they both began to make their own. Where, no matter if it was just a street lamp that illuminated their night, they remained together. Rumi Yusujiyama has never been known for being a girl who lets her sensitivity show. She is a strong, independent and reliable girl. An undeniable prospect for Japan's top hero. A soft sigh escaped her lips. "I never thought choosing a gift for a boy would be this complicated." So, yes, Rumi Yusujiyama would have to find a reason for choosing a Christmas gift for Izuku Midoriya. She would attribute it to the fact that he was kind to her and gave her a couple of carrot cakes, her favorites, by the way. That boy accompanied her in intimate moments of her life and that lastly, he had made her daily routine less every day. But besides that, there was the possibility of something else existing. "Since when do I care about those details?" The girl questioned herself in an annoyed whisper as she grabbed any object that was near her presence and left there. Only for her to return a couple of seconds later not being completely satisfied. "Stupid bush boy." A new sigh came from her lips. "The geeky kid likes all those geeky hero things." A fierce smile appeared on his face, already having a clear idea. As she set out on her way with that resolution in mind, her ferocious smile disappeared the moment she caught sight of the 1001 hero things around her. Frustrated, Rumi grabbed a toy of the hero All Might and threw it into the air, landing on a child's head. The boy let out a small cry of surprise as his mother looked at Rumi disapprovingly. She mumbled a small apology before looking away, feeling more frustrated. Rumi kept thinking about Izuku as she walked through the mall. Why do I care so much about you being happy because of something I do for you? She sighed. Maybe I want to give you a little of all the happiness you bring to me. The mist that escaped from her lips slightly accentuated how red her little nose was due to the cold. The long brown cotton jacket, the ear protectors of the same material and a skirt accompanied by a pair of thermal socks protected her from the winter cold that had been turning into snowflakes for a couple of days now. She continued to be lost in her thoughts without any direction. The soft sensation she felt on her shoulder and the voice behind her made her wake up. She looked up and searched her surroundings. And there he was in front of her nose. His smile accompanied by his pair of freckles and his bright green eyes. His smile grew sharper when he saw who it was. Were you so eager to see me? Guilty. A small giggle left her lips. Rumi started walking towards him. She was beginning to hate how her little nose and tail moved involuntarily every time he appeared, no matter how much she tried to hide it, they always managed to give her away somehow. Christmas shopping? Rumi nodded at the boy's question. Who will be lucky enough to be enlightened by a gift from you? Someone. Rumi's dry response made Izuku look at her questioningly. Don't be jealous, brat. A mocking giggle left her lips to try to provoke Izuku. I'm jealous. The boy answered seriously as he got a little closer to the girl. I would feel really bad if I wasn't that person. Rumi looked at him instantly. The blush on her cheeks at his unexpected reaction was not long in coming. Her surprised gaze fell on Izuku, who was still looking at her seriously. And maybe that person is you. She whispered hesitantly, looking away. A smile appeared on Izuku's face instantly. I was joking, but I'm glad to know that, Miss Rumi. Izuku took a couple of steps away from Rumi, who looked at him upon hearing Izuku's response. The boy turned around with a smile. I'm starving, the boy smiled, glancing at Rumi. How about we spend this day together? Rumi looked around at her surroundings so that Izuku couldn't notice the blush on her cheeks that betrayed her embarrassment. I hope you know how to choose a good place to eat, brat. She wanted to sound rude, confident. She failed. They both began to walk, separated by just a couple of centimeters. It didn't take long for laughter and words to begin to rain between them. The pasta with meat they ate, the chocolate dessert they shared. The laughter that escaped from their lips while they chatted and walked aimlessly. All of that was something new that Rumi Yusujiyama was experiencing for the first time, and although she didn't like to admit it to the air, inside she was beginning to feel uncomfortable about continuing to keep all of that to herself. It's like I'm smoking. Izuku expelled some cold air from his mouth, simulating a bit of smoke. They were walking through the night city illuminated by streetlights and stars. The night welcomed them, and with it, the dawn of the icy December wind welcomed them. You act like a three-year-old. Rumi mentioned, watching as Izuku played at being a high-ranking mobster who smoked a bit of his cigar exported from Italy. Four, Miss Rumi, I'm 4 years old. And be careful how you talk to me or you'll end up in a bag. A blow from the girl on his head interrupted him. They continued walking. The silence between paragraphs was only to catch their breath from their laughter. The constant glances that Rumi cast on Izuku without him realizing it were beginning to embarrass her. As much as she wanted not to, she always found herself immersed in his bright green eyes. After a while, they both arrived at the train station where Rumi had to go. She had insisted on going alone, she could defend herself, and it was no wonder. Izuku ignored her and decided to stay by her side. I hope to see you soon, Miss Rumi. A small smile appeared on his face as he watched her. Rumi nodded delicately. Since they both arrived at their destination, the girl had remained in a strange silence for her that Izuku noticed. Rum. Hey. Rumi interrupted Izuku's call. The boy allowed Rumi to speak. His embarrassed look and his cheeks that were slowly fading into crimson took center stage. Why, you see, it's almost Christmas. Izuku nodded at what she said. Are you going to do something that day? Izuku nodded. I'll be with Mom. I'll make some dinner and give her the gift I bought for her. The boy held up a small bag he had bought earlier on his journey with Rumi. The rabbit girl nodded weakly as she sighed. Her heart was pounding, and even though she wanted to scream it out, she just couldn't. Rumi Yusujiyama had a stage in the academy focused on being a hero that had limited her abilities to express what she wanted. She internally cursed herself for her lack of ability to speak and began to envy Izuku and his sporadic way of expressing his desires. Well, see you later, brat. The girl let out a small, heavy sigh. As she turned around to leave, Izuku's call stopped her instantly. Will you do something? Rumi watched him faintly as she shook her head with a subtle gesture. Would you like to spend Christmas with me? Her nervous smile mixed with her blushing cheeks. Maybe I would like to spend that day with you, Miss Rumi. Hearing those words, everything around her fell silent. The icy wind that blew in her face and messed up her white hair instantly enveloped her. The soft snowflakes that fell from the sky and kissed her face, melting on it, witnessed how her breathing accelerated. Her heart began to dance strongly and her eyes filled with an inexplicable emotion that only her smile flashed instantly. "I'd love to, Izuku." Rumi Yusujiyama's plausible smile was something Izuku had never seen before. It radiated from every angle. Her red eyes shone so warmly that they invited him to stay and admire them for an eternity, and his heart, upon hearing her lips pronounce his name, had no room in his chest. "So it's a date, Rumi," he said with the greatest joy. Rumi nodded and, still keeping a smile on her face, watched as Izuku turned around to leave. Her heart was still beating, there was still something else that needed to be done to calm him down. And before she could even react, she felt the wind caressing her face once more as she followed Izuku's back, who, upon noticing her presence, turned to look at her. "Is something wrong?" His voice fell silent instantly. Her arms were around him completely. He could feel her heavy breathing on his chest and her head sinking into his. Her rabbit ears brushed his nose from the constant movement caused by the icy wind, and he subtly managed to move his hands towards them, taking them gently. "Thank you, Izuku." Her soft voice that showed all her embarrassment was muffled because her face was on his chest, and yet, all that warmth reached him. Izuku didn't take any longer and firmly caught Rumi, making their hug even warmer. "Are you in a hurry to leave?" the boy asked so softly that only she heard him. "I would like to be like this for a while longer." Rumi felt her face heat up in a unique way. The warmth in her chest that was beating strongly intertwined with the beating of Izuku's heart, and with subtlety, she snuggled a little closer to Izuku. "I'll take that as a no." The snowflakes fell and they both stood, holding on to each other. Rumi met Izuku in the last days of autumn. It had been a while since the leaves that used to fall freely from the trees had transformed into laughter and cakes for her. Now with the arrival of the snowflakes, her heart was racing to know what direction her life would take. If Rumi Yusujiyama had to find a reason to excuse her nerves when she was in front of that door, she could say that a dangerous villain was behind it. Mirko, the hero council, never felt nervous in front of a villain, but that would be her alibi. "Don't be a coward, Rumi Yusujiyama," the girl scolded herself in a whisper. The soft snowflakes that fell in harmonious silence let themselves unfold in her presence. Some of them intertwined in her long, delicate white hair. Her ears were uncovered only for that day, and her little nose moved in a soft crimson due to the cold. "Don't be a coward." Rumi looked up at the night sky. The softness of the faint moonlight that fell upon her red eyes took her in as a pause, from which her soft lips let out a small sigh. "I was starting to miss you." The voice in front of her took her by surprise. She quickly turned her gaze towards where it came from, where a warm smile and a pair of soft green eyes greeted her. "TSK." He looked away with some embarrassment. "It's cold, brat." Izuku let out a small laugh and cautiously invited Rumi into his home. Warmth greeted her instantly. Soft jazz music played in the background and the sweet aroma of coffee and cake completely intoxicated her senses. Rumi was guided by the boy to the living room where everything was ready. The record player in a corner of the room, on the small coffee table, three cups of coffee and a couple of desserts for company, and on one of the sofas, that lady from the cafeteria waited with a sweet smile. "Miss Rumi, I'm glad you're here." A gentle hug took her by surprise. The short, green-haired lady was hugging her gently. A little startled, Rumi looked at Izuku, who laughed lightly. "My son has told me so much about you that I already feel like you're a part of the family," she mentioned with a soft smile. Hearing that, the bunny girl's face turned softly red. Her tail slowly moved and her foot tapped. Rumi moved her gaze towards Izuku, who smiled softly at her again, but now above his freckles, a faint crimson accompanied him. Time passed fleetingly. As the music continued to advance, the night kept her company. The coffee and dessert ran out. The laughter increased and the gifts were given. They were both walking under the snowflakes that the freezing night had given them. Soft flashes of steam escaping from their lips accompanied their steps on the snow. "Your mother is very sweet," Rumi decided to break the silence as they continued walking. "It always has been." The boy smiled. "I don't know if I mentioned it, but you're the first girl I've brought home." "You chose the best option, brat." The girl laughed in an exaggerated manner while gently hitting the boy's arm. "It was." The boy smiled, glancing at the girl. "I really like that option." They both continued walking in silence. Neither of them exchanged anything beyond sidelong glances. Izuku, trying to revive the atmosphere, wanted to say something that was interrupted by the girl's unexpected action. Rumi was dragging Izuku along. She held his hand in hers in a gentle but firm grip. Izuku, although bewildered, let the girl take control. It was not until they were under a gigantic tree that Rumi broke the grip and moved a couple of centimeters away from the boy. Hey. Izuku was the first to say something. Miss Rumi, is everything okay? Shut up. The girl interrupted him. Rumi closed the distance between them, approaching him gently. From her coat she pulled out a small box with a green and white wrapping, which she held out towards Izuku. It's for you. I don't expect you to like it, it was the first thing I found. She lied, it took her all morning to choose something for him. Izuku smiled softly as he moved a little closer to her. With a slight gesture, he took the gift and proceeded to open it. A pendant with the silhouette of a rabbit lit up before his eyes and beneath it, a small handwritten note caught his attention, mainly because of the title of this letter. Thank you for being my hero. Izuku watched in silence. Rumi, though he didn't want to say it, was terrified of that silence. The tapping of his foot intensified as his anxiety grew. He didn't know if she had liked his gift, and that was starting to distress him. At least say something, not. Her complaint was muffled. Izuku had eliminated all distance between them. A strong hug took hold of her, who, surprised, was slow to react but instantly gently intensified the hug. Since I was a child, that had always been my dream. The boy moved away slightly and moved his hands to Rumi's cheeks. With a gentle gesture he made his green eyes meet her deep red ones in harmony. I didn't know if I could become a hero for this nation, but knowing that I can be your hero is better than anything in this world. Rumi listened attentively to everything Izuku said. She remained absorbed in him. His smile and his warm gaze on her made a shiver run through her entire presence. TSK. Rumi looked away a few times as she usually did when she was embarrassed. Her little nose twitching wildly already gave away her embarrassment as usual when she was near him. They both remained silent. That little amount of sensory sound beyond the snowflakes falling freely enveloped them warmly. Hey! Her call caught the boy's attention. What would you do if I do something reckless? You, asking about reckless things? She let out a small laugh. You're an expert at that. Rumi lightly hit Izuku's arm as the boy laughed again. They were both still standing under the gigantic tree that provided shade and now, blurred the constant snowflakes that threatened to invade their evening. I'm serious. Izuku glanced at the girl. Her subtle voice accompanied her embarrassed face. It might annoy her, but his heart wanted to listen to her a little more. What's wrong, Rumi? The rabbit girl sighed a little and hesitantly raised her gaze to the sky slightly illuminated by stars. There's something I want to do but I'm scared, she mentioned in a warm whisper. I've never felt anything like this and it's what scares me the most, you know? Me, the great and powerful Rumi Usagiyama, being terrorized by a 17-year-old brat. Izuku was attentive to everything that came out of her lips. He confirmed the words came out of her, a smile was painted on his face. His cheeks and freckles were tinted in a soft red and his gaze was focused on her. I hesitate. I don't know how to say it. Quickly, Rumi stood up, embarrassed and inexperienced, taking a few steps away from him. Izuku smiled a little and slowly and gently began to walk to where she was. Rumi Usagiyama, 21 years old, you are in the process of becoming a spectacular heroine, Izuku began to speak as he continued walking. You like carrot cakes, sweetened coffee, and having your ears caressed. Rumi stopped walking, her face expressing her embarrassment. Her gaze under her frown accompanied the crimson of her cheeks that only burned in exaggeration as Izuku spoke. Even though her gaze was turned away from him, the warmth she transmitted to him came in a soft, icy breath. You are terrified of the dark and have little patience. You are rude, coarse and cruel. Selfish like no one else and you sleep hugging a stuffed frog that your mother gave you when you were a child. Her heart began to pound. She could have broken into a punch, a shout, or even an insult, but she let the boy continue. You present yourself to everyone as a strong, tough girl. And you are, but on top of that you are a sensitive girl who just wants someone to hug her and never let her go. With each word that spit out from her mouth dictated by her heart, the gap between them became smaller to the point where only subtle flashes of her harmonious presence vanished between them. I don't know what I have to do to make you happy. But I'm sure that I will build a new world if you want it. In the end, as in the beginning of everything, their eyes met softly. Izuku kept a subtle smile on his crimson cheeks. Rumi tried to wander around her surroundings to try to make her embarrassment go away, something that never happened. The gentle icy wind of a fleeting but new Christmas for both of them embraced them. TSK. After so much determination, Rumi succumbed to what her heart desired. Why you don't have to do anything, brat. A soft laugh took over Izuku, much to the girl's embarrassment. I'm glad to know. Rising slightly, Rumi silenced Izuku by pulling him towards her with a sharp movement where she grabbed his shoulders to have him right in front of her. It was a subtle gesture where, after so much, Rumi took over Izuku's lips in a tender kiss. She wrapped her arms around the boy's neck and her breathing began to weigh down when his arms surrounded her hips. Seconds passed where they both floated in the sky, being one with those snowflakes that fell in an ethereal silence where their fleeting fall would bring them back to reality. Why, you have no choice now, boy. You belong to me now. She said in a small whisper. Rumi gently pulled away to stare at Izuku. She wouldn't look for any other point to look at than those green eyes. His nose that moved gently without disdain and his gesticulation of his little tail only increased. What am I going to do? Izuku laughed subtly. You'll have to take responsibility, Miss Rumi. His blushing face turned to her. Now it was Izuku who bridged the gap again. His lips met hers again and without any preamble, they merged for the second time. Although it was less clumsy than the first, the sensation of the heaviness of their breathing intertwined smoothly. Rumi adjusted her grip on him and feeling those flakes of fever on her nose complemented the discharge that Izuku made run through her entire body. After a while, both boys remained in a soft embrace, oblivious to their surroundings. It's starting to get cold, the girl rested her head on his chest, making the hug firmer. I know. The boy finished wrapping Rumi in his hug. They both remained silent, the embrace between them firmly reaffirmed and the warmth of their bodies enveloped them. Under the moonlight of a fleeting Christmas, Rumi and Izuku remained together infinitely under the fine snowflakes that caressed them sweetly, being the only witnesses of the talk of their hearts. If Rumi Yusujiyama had to find an explanation for her excessive concern about making a decent dinner, she could attribute it to the fact that she was always a perfectionist. She liked everything to turn out well and the way she wanted. I wasn't wrong. The girl growled at the tutorial she was watching on her phone. You were wrong, you crappy teacher. Her annoyed face stained with 1001 ingredients from her many failed attempts to cook something was what dominated her kitchen. Rumi had decided to take the reins of being the hostess for the New Year's dinner. In her previous years she limited herself to ordering fast food, making it look like she had made it and that was it, problem solved. Stupid cute bush boy. It's all your fault, she whispered in a tired sigh. But now there was enough of a green reason to make him change his routine. The girl looked at the wall clock. There were just over 2 hours left until the agreed time arrived. Defeated, she let herself fall to the kitchen floor. She closed her eyes and let out an exhausted sigh from her lips. After a few moments, the doorbell of her apartment rang. Come in. His call was loud but subtle, denoting his tiredness. The opening and closing of the door took place, as his footsteps approached where she was. His subtle giggle made her frown in annoyance, but she was filled with happiness that he was there. I came as fast as I could when I saw your message. I thought when you asked for help it was for something more difficult. The boy let out a soft chuckle again. TSK, he grumbled. Don't bother me, brat. A brief silence enveloped them both. Rumi slowly opened her eyes as she noticed the absence of words and as she did so, her sight focused on a soft smile accompanied by a pair of freckles who extended their hand towards her. Come on, the great heroine Mirko can't be defeated by a couple of peppers and meat. Rumi stared at the boy's gesture. His gaze on her, observing her like never before, made her feel ashamed and, sighing, she gently took the boy's hand until she stood up. Let's go. Izuku's speech was interrupted by an unexpected hug from Rumi. She clung to his chest and hid her face in it, making her ears tickle his nose. Her heart beating faster and faster took control of her presence. I'm glad you're here, with red cheeks and the embarrassment of the world, Rumi whispered. Izuku smiled softly as he gently stroked Rumi's little ears. I'm glad to be here. See? It wasn't that hard. The boy smiled with satisfaction. It's easy to say when your mom is a great chef and you've been practicing since you were a kid. The girl frowned as she watched Izuku, who smiled provocatively at her. The night for both of them turned into a team effort where both, in sync, cooked that dinner. Rumi accepted the guilt of watching Izuku with admiration with every word that came out of him. Watching him happy, smiling and excited infected her with that happiness. In an instant, a surge of nostalgia. Her life had changed in a few meters as if it were a couple of bunny hops. Her soft gaze fell on Izuku who, returning her gaze, smiled warmly at her and moved his hand to her cheek. Dessert is missing, can you help me with this? Rumi nodded warmly and moved her hand to the boy's hand on her cheek and held it firmly, leaving him with no way out. Izuku just smiled at her and mimicked her action, reaffirming their soft bond. Ha 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 ha. Rumi's exaggerated laughter instantly infected Izuku. "How did that happen?" the boy asked, catching his breath. They were both under a cloud of sugar and flour. The simplest job of making a carrot cake for dessert had turned into a sea of spices. At first it started with a little flour on Izuku's face by Rumi and vice versa. That game escalated until all the ingredients were used, completely staining everything around them. "Now it's our turn to clean." The boy was interrupted by a splash of flour on his face. "Hee hee." Rumi smiled gracefully, preparing another batch of flour. "You've got three to run, kid. And that's two," Izuku mentioned playfully as he headed towards Rumi. The bunny girl started laughing carefree as she ran away from the boy all around her apartment. Their laughter combined into that sweet cloud that began to spread out around them. "Mine!" Izuku finally shouted, catching Rumi in his arms. They both fell to the ground while laughing. Izuku was on the ground and Rumi was lying on top of him. They both stared at each other with a small smile on their lips and a soft, gentle blush on their cheeks. "Why don't you kiss me already, brat?" Rumi mentioned, staring at the boy. "I was waiting for you to do it." Izuku's smile made her a little more embarrassed. Instantly, her face began to burn and her breathing became heavy. Her little nose began to twitch and her little tail gave her away instantly. "But I understand that you can't do it." Izuku Midoriya knew how to provoke Rumi Usagiyama. "It takes a lot of courage." Rumi simply remained silent, not taking her eyes off her prey. Her serious look combined with the embarrassment on her cheeks and she gently approached Izuku's face. At first it was a short and tender kiss, and when it ended, they both continued staring at each other in silence. "Is that bravery enough?" Rumi whispered with a blush. "I don't know. Try again," Izuku answered in the same way. Rumi repeated her previous gesture and returned to ponder the boy's lips, but this time it was a longer kiss. One that was followed by another, and another. Izuku, still on the ground and under her, moved his hands to the girl's hips. Rumi let out a sigh when she felt the boy's touch, an action that only made the kisses increase. "It's bad to eat dessert before the main course," Rumi whispered gracefully while watching the boy. Izuku let out a soft chuckle. "Imagine the world ending right now. I'd die happy if I ate dessert first." A soft giggle enveloped them both. Rumi stood up with Izuku and they both continued with their main mission. They prepared a simple evening. On the balcony of their apartment they placed a table and a couple of chairs. A candle in the center illuminated the starry night sky where the moon was a special guest for both of them. Izuku and Rumi spent the night laughing and joking. When it was all over, they were in a soft silence enjoying each other. "Do you have any goals for this new year?" Rumi asked, looking at the stars. "I have a couple." Izuku smiled softly. "But I think the most important one is right next to me." A soft gust greeted them both. Rumi's white hair floated freely in a silence that was evoked by a soft giggle from her. "What a coincidence. We have the same goal." They both smiled softly at each other. Izuku subtly led his hand to Rumi's hand. With a soft play of their fingers, they both intertwined their union under the bright stars of a new year for both of them. The city has always been chaotic and noisy. The abundance of people with their own thoughts flooded the streets where a different story reigned for everyone. Under those last glimmers of the sunset, her white hair moved freely in the soft gusts of wind that gently caressed her face and her walk continued in the same fixed direction. "Carrot cake," he whispered instantly as his senses heightened. His little nose began to twitch and his long little ears turned to the spot where that aroma had intoxicated him. She instantly let her instincts take over and she deviated from her usual path. The skirt she wore as a uniform began to move in sync with the backpack she carried on her back. After a few moments of following her instincts, she lowered the cover of a giant tree that provided shade, and a small black-haired boy was sitting there. Subtly, that girl discreetly approached where that boy was under the tree. In her hands, a small slice of carrot cake rested next to a single spoon. The girl with long, little bunny ears stared at that dessert as she arrived next to that boy. "Hey." The little boy spoke slightly nervous about the unexpected appearance. Focusing better, he noticed how the girl was completely ignoring him as she was absorbed in looking at the dessert. A soft giggle took over the boy and he took a small piece of cake and brought it close to the girl. "Ha," the little girl, bewildered, looked at the boy. "Do you like carrots?" she asked with a little giggle. The girl nodded gently and the boy again offered the small piece of cake he had broken off a few moments ago. "For me?" the girl asked confusedly, receiving a nod. The little girl took the spoon and brought it to her mouth. The softness of the carrot cake instantly intoxicated her instincts. Her green eyes instantly sparkled, and on her cheeks, those little freckles blushed, and her bunny ears instantly began to move. "They are just as delicious as the ones Dad makes," the girl murmured. The boy laughed a little, watching the girl's tender gesture, and imitated her action, devouring a small piece of that cake. "My name is Toru," the boy said. "What's yours?" The little girl looked at him. "My name?" A small smile appeared on her face. "My name is Dai. Dai Midoriya." "I'm nervous," the boy whispered. "It's okay." A fierce smile appeared on his face. "Besides, you said you wanted to meet them. Don't be a coward." The two children were standing right in front of the door of a small bakery in a not-so-busy part of the city. The sign. The softness of the last rays of the sun that illuminated them both was reflected on them. "Let's go." The girl enthusiastically took the boy's hand, and they entered the room, much to the boy's nervousness. As they entered the bakery, the light sound of a bell and the sweet aroma of desserts and coffee enveloped both of them. "Oh. But it's you." A male voice spoke from behind the kitchen. "Welcome, you little rascal." Dai let go of the boy's hand and ran towards where the voice came from. At the same time the door was opened, and from it, a tall man with green hair and freckles stepped out, a soft smile on his face. His freckles were still visible and the subtle hints of beard on his face. The small, long-eared girl clung to Izuku in a hug that he reciprocated. After a few seconds, Izuku spotted the small boy who had been standing behind them, nervous and embarrassed. "Won't you introduce me to your friend?" Izuku mentioned. "Oh. Of course." The little girl smiled and separated from her father until she reached the little boy, who took him by the hand and dragged him until he was close to him. "This is Toru, and I really wanted to meet you," she mentioned with an energetic smile, embarrassing the boy. "Hey." The boy muttered nervously, looking away. A soft chuckle left Izuku's lips as he crouched down to be at the small, embarrassed boy's height. "Nice to meet you, Toru. I'm Izuku Midoriya, father of this little rascal." Instantly, Toru's eyes lit up. "Nice to meet you," he said with a big smile. "Mom always buys cakes from here, and they are the best." Izuku smiled softly and continued chatting with both children. A small slice of chocolate cake and a couple of drinks accompanied their little chat. As the night continued under that small cake shop, the children continued in their little world, and Izuku watched them from afar with a soft smile. "What makes you so happy?" A voice behind him called unexpectedly. "Everything." Izuku smiled. "Welcome back, Rumi." A smile spread across her. Her bunny ears began to move softly, and the light blush on her cheeks focused on him. "Did you miss me?" she asked. "Why did I?" Rumi hugged Izuku and hid her face on his chest. Her ears brushing his nose became a habit over the years. That her little nose and her thing moved without disdain every time he hugged her was something that, since their first days of knowing each other, was something that Izuku found endearing. "Can you help me with something?" Izuku asked, breaking the hug. Rumi nodded, slightly puzzled. "What would it be?" She was interrupted by an unexpected kiss from Izuku. He grabbed her hips, pulling her towards him. Their bodies were joined by a soft grip on his part that was grabbed by Rumi's arms, who wrapped them around Izuku's neck. Their breaths instantly mingled, and their hearts began to dance in unison to the same song under another everyday night. They both separated subtly, staring at each other. Red and green combined once again as they had done a couple of years ago. "I'm still so in love with you, Rumi Yusajiyama," Izuku mentioned, caressing the rabbit girl's cheek. Rumi looked away from Izuku's lips and then back to his eyes. The blush on her cheeks and the involuntary twitching of her little nose betrayed her happiness. "I'm glad to hear that. Because I'm still more in love than you, Izuku Midoriya." Rumi moved her hand to Izuku's hand, both holding each other firmly, and on their fingers, a wedding ring dazzled on them. "There's a little rascal waiting for you," Izuku mentioned. Rumi smiled fiercely and took Izuku by the hand, dragging him towards that little girl with white hair, bunny ears, green eyes, and freckles on her cheeks. "Mom!" The cry of excitement echoed throughout the place. Little Dai rushed into a hug that Rumi instantly returned. Behind them both, with a smile on his face, Izuku watched that scene that was so everyday for him, but that he never got bored of seeing. "Come. Come." Dai took his parents' hands, dragging them towards where the nervous little boy was. Dai began to talk energetically about the incredible adventures of his mother, the heroine Mirko. Rumi, with absolute happiness, watched with an indelible smile the interaction of his little daughter with her father and friend. "I was always bored with the everyday. I never appreciated the beauty in it. Until you came along," Rumi mentioned in her mind while she continued expectantly with that smile. "I don't know what will become of my future, but I hope you too will always be here. A hand on hers brought her out of her thoughts. Looking at those green eyes accompanied by those freckles that had given a twist to her daily life since the first day, her heart began to beat faster. Rumi looked away, watching her little daughter chatting enthusiastically with her new friend. She rested her head on Izuku's shoulder, and both of them, standing in silence, observed everything they had built over the years. Their dreams. Goals. Objectives. Passions that developed into virtues and defects that were perfected in love. It was not easy for either of them, but they had done it together. At a bunny hop pace.